Good afternoon. I'm Dr. Jaz Atwal, Deputy Chief Provincial Public Health Officer for Manitoba. Today, there are four additional deaths due to COVID-19. I want to offer my condolences to their family, friends, and loved ones. The current five-day COVID-19 test positivity rate is 11.4% provincially and 13% in Winnipeg. As of 9:30 a.m. today, 329 new cases of the virus have been identified in Manitoba. And the total number of lab-confirmed cases in Manitoba is 52,261. On May 27, Public Health extended the current orders due to the high COVID case numbers and the ongoing strain on our healthcare system. We are almost a full week into those extended measures, and we are seeing some improvement. But we are not out of the woods yet. Our day-to-day case numbers are getting a bit better, but our healthcare system is still struggling. There are still too many people in hospital today needing care. There are too many people in ICUs, both in Manitoba and outside of the province, struggling for their lives. Manitobans have the power to help stem the third wave. We have to stay home as much as we can and reduce our number of close contacts. And we have to make an appointment to get vaccinated. Every Manitoban over the age of 12 is eligible for vaccine, and if you got your first vaccination before April 25, you can now book your second appointment. It is up to all of us to take steps to protect each other. By taking action and changing our behaviors, we will bring cases down and help end the third wave in Manitoba. To bring an end to this and start getting our lives back to normal, you can get vaccinated, practice the fundamentals, and stay home. We're seeing an early heat wave in southern Manitoba right now. Temperatures expected to reach the high 30s today and over the weekend. Heat can have serious effects on people's physical health, mental well-being, and cognitive ability. However, older adults, people with chronic illness, people living alone, infants and young children, and people who work or exercise in the heat have a particularly high risk for heat illness. Heat illnesses are preventable. Be sure to take care of yourself and others. Wednesday, we made a few minor amendments to the public health orders to accommodate this heat wave. Municipalities are temporarily permitted to repurpose facilities such as libraries and community centers as cooling centers for vulnerable people who may not otherwise have a means to cool off during heat waves. The change allows for the operation of outdoor pools, splash pads, and wading pools at hotels, campgrounds, and other private businesses. Please note that these services are available for those who do not readily have heat relief options to them. If you have air conditioning, a pool or a sprinkler at home, the community pool or splash pads are not to be used as a family outing. Restrictions on gatherings and interactions with people who do not reside at the same private residence continue to apply. The orders are in effect until June 12 at 12:01 a.m. Further information about heat and your health can be found on the Manitoba Public Health website. Thank you. I can now take questions.
Thank you, Doctor. A reminder to our reporters on the line, you will have one preliminary and one follow-up question. Up first this afternoon from the Winnipeg Free Press, Katie.
Good afternoon, Dr. Atwal. I'm wondering about the immunization within personal care homes for staff. Do you know the proportion of personal care home staff that have been immunized, and is it enough vaccine coverage to consider changes to visitation policies in those facilities?
Yeah, I don't have specific details on immunization uptake among staff. We always encourage all Manitobans to get vaccinated. We encourage those in positions where they're taking care of others to make sure that they are vaccinated and get full vaccinations as well. So we'll continue to promote that. I don't have any specific numbers for you, though.
Okay. You said yesterday that we could still see hospitalizations continue to increase by 10 or 15% over the next couple of weeks. What kind of numbers or indicators are we looking at before we'll be able to relax some of the public health orders around outdoor gatherings and things like being able to go for a walk or an outdoor activity with someone outside your household?
Yeah, I mean, yesterday I said I it was a possibility they can go up. Again, I am hoping our numbers are plateauing right now, but again, time will tell. It wouldn't surprise me if the numbers do go up by about 10, 15% over the next week for hospitalizations and ICUs. Talking about the next set of orders, talking about how restrictions would come off Manitobans, I think it's a little too early to speculate on that. You know, we are looking at our numbers. We're looking at our acute care system. We're looking at our case counts. Our case counts are still high. They have come down. Our trailing average for 7 days is still close to 300. So, you know, we're going to have to wait on providing more information regarding orders and restrictions on the next set. We're going to have some discussions about it. And once more information is available, we'll provide that to the public.
From Global News, Joe.
Afternoon, Dr. Atwal. The Delta variant, it appears to be picking up steam in some parts of the country. Do we know how many Delta variant cases that we have right now in Manitoba?
We know a number in relation to how many have been sequenced. I don't have the number with me. We're looking, obviously, we have talked about how we screen for variants, different types of variants, like say the UK variant in the past that we did and the P1 variant or, the B1351 variant. The Delta variant or the B16172 variant, we don't have a screen for it at this point yet. So, the lab, both provincially and nationally, is working on screens for that variant. So once we have that, we'll have a better indicator in relation to how much of that infection is in Manitoba, how much of that variant is in Manitoba. But at this point, we just have some numbers related to sequencing, and I don't have those specific numbers.
Thank you. And on the topic of the Delta variant, there's been some talk in some areas about a fourth wave. Is the province concerned about a fourth wave here?
From a public health perspective, we're always worried about the next wave. We're in the third wave right now. We're going to be managing this third wave. We are managing it. We're going to work our way through it. You know, vaccinations are paramount in our ability to prevent, to manage this wave, to kind of get the numbers down really quick, to create that nadir, to create that plateau after the wave. And always, continue to think about what a fourth wave would look like, what it could potentially mean. You know, when we have variants, we're going to continue to see newer and newer variants. So the Delta variant is something that is newer. In a month, we'll probably have another variant, and maybe 2 or 3 months later, we'll have another variant. It's the behavior of the variants where we would have to take into account what the next wave could look like. Again, the more of Manitobans that get vaccinated, the less chance there is of a fourth wave. If we get vaccine escape, though, so if we get another variant where it escapes the vaccine's ability to mount immune response to it, that can cause a lot of cases as well and cause a large wave as well. So it's really hard to predict the future. I think at the present time, we need to focus on where we're at right now. We need to get our numbers down. We need to manage the third wave and get as many people vaccinated. Because even with many, many people vaccinated, we know some won't develop immunity. So we have to understand the risks related to the acute care system for those who don't develop immunity or for those who choose not to get immunized as well.
From the Brandon Sun, Kimberly.
Good afternoon. Can we just talk a little bit more about the expansion of the public health orders and the reopening of the cooling centers and splash pads and so on? I'm thinking, if you don't have some kind of regulation or somebody monitoring it, it's going to be a little bit of a free-for-all. So is enforcement going to be upped at these sites to make sure that only families are coming, or how is that going to happen?
So the operators of those sites will put into, whatever measures they feel are important to mitigate those types of issues. I think from a messaging standpoint, this isn't for recreation. You know, these sites are opening because we have a significant heat wave right now, which can have impacts on those vulnerable populations. This isn't about recreation. This isn't a family of four with two parents and two kids going who have air conditioning at home to go to a splash pad. This is, you know, maybe a single parent or two parents and two kids who, you know, live in a home without air conditioning, who don't have access to sprinklers or something, that they're able to kind of get out, cool down a little bit, stay for a short time, and go back home. So that's the messaging here. The messaging here is to, you know, in a pandemic, you know, with COVID restrictions, we have on top of that a heat wave. We have to worry about that. Those most impacted, again, are those vulnerable individuals that don't have a mechanism to cool down. This provides an opportunity to cool down, to maybe access an air-conditioned center, to sit, to cool down for a period of time and leave and then go back home. So on a messaging side, that is the messaging that we're providing, and I believe that's the messaging that the municipalities are providing as well.
Okay, thank you for that. My second question has to do with the two individuals that died from COVID that were transported to Ontario hospitals. My understanding was that those patients that were being transported were, for lack of a better word, the middle patients, the patients that were predictably going to survive the transportation and recovery in a hospital outside of the province, and yet we have a couple of people that have died. So I'm just wondering, are those people that are being transported, are they being screened to the point that they are stable enough to make the trip and that their survival rate is going to actually be there? Because we've got two people that have died in the last week that, you know, we're just wondering about that.
So my first and foremost, my sympathies to those families, to those individuals. It's tough. Yeah, you know, we came to a point in Manitoba here where we had to utilize resources in other provinces to manage our ICUs related to COVID illness. When someone gets admitted to the ICU, they're sick. You know, you're not being admitted there because you're not sick, obviously. You know, the risk of mortality for any ICU patient is actually quite high. We know with COVID, about 3 out of every 10 people who go into the ICU, roughly that number, pass on, and they pass on from their illness. So I know from a shared health perspective, you know, we are making sure that those who are able to get transported, who need to access an ICU bed, they're triaged. A lot of work is done with a number of physicians in relation to making sure that these individuals are safe to travel. The individuals who passed on, they were in other ICUs for a period of time and then they passed on. And that is tragic. That's sad. But it is sort of what we've always talked about with COVID. You know, that risk of mortality is there. We're seeing that mortality. We've always seen it throughout the pandemic. And we'll probably continue to see it, obviously. So right now, I think altogether, about 51 people have been sent out of province. Right now, I think there is 41 people out of province right now. So that's 41 Manitobans, because our ICUs are full, had to be taken to another province to get care. And all of those individuals would have had a really good assessment done by physicians to make sure that they were safe for transport. You know, some individuals do succumb. And again, it's about 30% of individuals who succumb to this illness once they hit the ICU.
From CJOB, Skyler.
Hi, Dr. Atwal. I know this, you know, the vaccine questions aren't exactly your scope here, but I'm hoping you could provide some clarity on just how effective that second shot is against a variant like the Delta variant, and how important it is for everyone who got their first shot to go back for that second shot.
You know, that's a great question. So a lot of the studies that were originally done were done on the wild strain of COVID. And obviously, since those studies have been done, the larger studies, you know, we've had variants come out, let's say the UK variant or the B117 variant. You know, there's a Delta variant now. So there's ongoing studies being done to look at how effective the vaccines are against the variants. And whether it's the B117 variant or the P1 variant or the Delta variant or the P1351 variant. early studies that we've seen, you know, show obviously two doses of vaccine for with an mRNA vaccine provides 95% vaccine effectiveness, you know, prevents illness, prevents hospitalizations and deaths with two doses against a wild strain. When we look at studies related to the UK variant, that number is very close to that, perhaps just a, you know, 1 or 2 percentage points shy of that. We're going to get more information as, you know, the world does more studies on this as well. And the same studies are being conducted with, let's say, the Delta variant or the B1351 variant, the P1 variant. And early indicators show, you know, good vaccine effectiveness, better with two doses, a lot better with two doses than one doses. So we still need Manitobans to make sure they get that second dose. So you got your first dose, you know, make sure you get that second dose. If you haven't had a dose yet, book that appointment, get that first dose. For our ability as Manitobans to manage COVID, you know, to limit the restrictions we have in the future, it is going to be dependent on how much immunity we have and the impacts on the acute care system. So again, you know, we know of some variants right now. Again, in a month, we might have another variant. And we don't know much about the next variant that's going to come until it comes. And it takes a few months to really understand the impacts of that variant from a communicability perspective, from an impact on the acute care system as well. So let's do our part. You know, again, if you are vaccinated, two doses, great. You know, if you got the one dose in, make sure you book your appointment for the second dose. If you don't have doses in yet, get that first dose. If you're vaccine hesitant, you know, get some real good information. Talk to your primary care provider. You know, talk to your nurse practitioner. Talk to your pharmacist. Call public health. And let's have a discussion about what vaccinations mean and what it means to you, what it can mean to your family, and talk about what are the hesitancy issues. We see a lot of hesitancy related to perhaps social media, perhaps related to a rumor, and we need to dispel those myths. You know, the vaccines are safe, vaccines are effective, and vaccines are what's going to be required for us to get back to those things that we want to do as Manitobans.
Thank you for that detailed answer. I know a lot of people are looking at, you know, the so-called herd immunity benchmark, whether it's 70 or 75 or maybe even a little bit higher, as some experts have said. And you know, once we've reached that, a lot of folks think, you know, that's essentially the end, or at least the end of widespread lockdowns and stuff like that. But as we, you know, what's the messaging going to be like, you know, as we slowly do start to reopen? Because I think a lot of people haven't thought much past that point, you know, where they're looking at the end of the second dose rollout. It's supposed to be mid-July or end of July, and then, you know, they expect things can get right back to normal after that. But what does that next couple of months look like in your eyes as we kind of move on?
Yeah, so the concept of herd immunity is when there's enough people in a population who are immunized to protect those who aren't. One of the bases for that, one of the fundamentals for that is for those who don't have immunity, they're randomly dispersed in a population as well. So we need good vaccine uptake from everyone in Manitoba, regardless of where you live. That's really important. Again, two doses. Will provide much more vaccine coverage than one dose. It'll provide a lot more protection, not only for you, but your family and your community compared to one dose. So we need those second doses coming in. The variants pose a question mark here on what herd immunity could look like. So we could throw out numbers today. I mean, people are already throwing out numbers, and those numbers could change in 2 weeks or in 1 month when we learn more about vaccine effectiveness related to the variants as well. What we do know is the greater number of people, the greater percentage of the population that gets vaccinated with two doses, the greater chance there is to develop really good herd immunity. Even with high uptake of vaccine, you know, we're still going to have individuals who were vaccinated properly who might not develop immunity. That's just the nature of vaccines, right? So if 100 people got two doses of an mRNA vaccine, that means five didn't develop immunity. When you add those numbers up at a population level, that's still quite a bit of people. And that could still have impacts with infections because, you know, COVID is still going to circulate. COVID isn't going away. It's around the world. We're going to see other variants come. We might see, you know, less impactful variants in relation to communicability or in relation to risk of hospitalization. And on the opposite side of that, we could see something more aggressive again. And that's important to realize because all those things will have an impact on the acute care system. So the messaging here is, you know, let's keep that in our in our sights here. You know, the next couple of months is important with second doses, first doses and second doses. And it is sort of hard to predict that future because, again, you know, another variant might come along. And even with the known variants, I think there's some question marks there in relation to true vaccine effectiveness with one and two doses and what percent of the population is required to get immunized. But as Manitobans, if we do our part, if everyone who is able to go get that vaccine gets that vaccine and gets that second dose, that'll put us in a much better position. Even if a vaccine escape variant does come, or if a variant arises that where the vaccine isn't as effective. So I think Manitobans really should listen to that advice.
From the Winnipeg Sun, Scott.
Hi, good afternoon, Dr. Atwal. The question just regarding herd immunity, has that number... That 70% number, has that changed? And yesterday the Premier said that, you know, if we have roughly 400,000 people not immunized, we should be bracing for a fourth wave. So I'm curious, you know, what is the herd immunity number that we need to get to then?
Again, that's a challenging question. I think I alluded to a number of variables that could impact that. You know, previously, I know the number, you know, 70, 75% has been used. We've sort of used some of those numbers, but obviously things change. You know, again, with a variants coming or they're already here, the dominant strain is, let's say, the UK variant right now. In a couple months, could the dominant strain be something different? And could a new strain develop as well? And again, you know, that concept of herd immunity is based on what we know about the circulating strain. And some of those numbers related to herd immunity were related to the wild strain. So we know that the variants of concern are more communicable. We know that the vaccines are likely not as effective, meaning they're not 95% effective with two doses compared to, let's say, the UK strain. It's going to be a little less effective, you know, versus the wild strain where the original studies were done. So are we going to see a fourth wave? You know, that's a possibility. And coupled with that, this last year, you know, we really didn't see a wave related to other respiratory illnesses because Manitobans had a lot of, you know, restrictions put on them. We had a lot of processes in place to mitigate respiratory illnesses because the same things that prevent COVID, prevent other respiratory illnesses. So we really had no influenza season. We really had no RSV season. So we need to take that into account as well. You know, we're still going to have, again, some people that just don't have immunity to COVID. And when we look at what could happen in the fall with the fourth wave, which is what people are predicting, those other respiratory illnesses will factor into that. And again, I think that's too far down the road to really provide, you know, detailed information about, really good information about, because things are going to change between now and then. So again, right now, we're in our third wave. The case numbers are coming down, but our ICUs are full. They're so full, we're moving people out of province. You know, our hospitalizations are high. We're still, you know, canceling surgeries, so people have to wait for surgeries. So we still need to worry about where we're at right now. And where we're at right now is we need to, you know, stay at home, limit our interactions, limit our close contacts with people. If you're sick, stay at home, go get tested, isolate your family until that test result comes back. And again, get vaccinated. You know, so again, if you got the one dose, book your second appointment. If you've got two, great. If you're vaccine hesitant, again, seek out really good information from trusted people. Don't go to social media. You know, talk to your primary care provider, talk to your nurse practitioner, talk to a pharmacist, contact your local public health unit.
Thanks for that. Just to follow up, you know, it's been a few weeks since we were kind of teased with a reopening plan, and not just necessarily just, you know, affirmed dates, but just hope, I suppose, for people. You know, if we get to these certain numbers for vaccinations, they'll get to see it. I mean, currently we can't really do a whole lot right now. You can't even go outside and meet a friend. You know, when will we see a reopening plan that offers hope for Manitobans?
Yeah, that's a great question. I know we've alluded to a plan. We've talked about it. We're finalizing some material related to that as well. So I mean, once something is finalized, we'll provide that to the public. I just don't have anything to provide right now.
From CBC Radio Canada, Zoe.
Good afternoon, Dr. Atwal. we're seeing Manitoban patients who are being transferred to other provinces. Is the province in current discussions to increase the number of beds in ICUs right now?
Yeah, so, you know, all along during the pandemic, even prior to the third wave, you know, there's been a lot of effort to increase our acute care capacity, to plan to have a net new increase in capacity. So not shifting resources from one area of the system to another. So that work is still undergoing. You know, we're graduating, from my understanding, many more nurses who are ICU capable. It does take a long time to generate a brand new body, a brand new nurse or a brand new doctor. Obviously, that takes many years because it involves education. It involves many years of education and some experience. So right now, you know, there is a lot of work being done to increase our net new beds in ICU. I think there will be some further information available next week on that. But it is challenging. You know, we have an acute care system. We have a system that's always run lean. I've been in medicine for close to 20 years, and it was lean 20 years ago. You know, we've always had issues related to capacity, acute care system, even back then. We've had it all along, and we're seeing some of those issues related to that. It's not just unique to Manitoba. I think a lot of jurisdictions have the same issue as well. So, you know, a lot of work is being done. You have to remind ourselves, too, for every one ICU bed, I believe it's 4.2 full-time equivalents of nurses that are required to manage that one bed. So one client in one bed is 4.2 full-time equivalent nurses. So it's a lot of person power that's required to manage somebody in ICU as well. And when we're developing these individuals, you know, we have to find them, we have to train them and get them working in that system. But sometimes we're taking them away from maybe another part of the system. That's not our goal, that's not our desire, but that's something we have to do right now. So there'll be more information on this next week in relation to ICU and building local ICU capacity and how it has been built and where we're at right now. So there'll be some information next week for the public in relation to that.
Thank you for that. If we look at the latest data or numbers, do we see a recent increase of people being vaccinated and admitted to ICUs?
Yeah, so I don't have the details of that. We're analyzing information on a regular basis. We do know our ICUs are impacted. We do know our hospitalizations are impacted by those not vaccinated. We have looked at those numbers, and you know, at one point in time, I think it was about 2 weeks ago that we looked at that number. We're going to continue to look at that number, but I don't have any updated numbers related to that. And we are working towards getting those numbers and other numbers in relation to hospital use and ICU use as well.
From CBC Manitoba, Bart.
Hi, Dr. Atwal. Okay, so we're at a 7-day average case count of 306, down from 482 on May 22nd. We've got slight decrease in test positivity rates, and total ICU patients are down, not significantly, but down single digits from earlier this week. What is the maximum daily case count, test positivity, and ICU burden before you'd even consider relaxing some restrictions?
Yeah, I mean, that's a good question. I mean, you know, those are some of the indicators we look at. I think we're going to be working with our acute care system to understand what their capacity is as well. So that's another variable to add into that. Obviously, we need our case numbers coming down more and more. You know, we need to look at our vaccination numbers and the age cohorts that are vaccinated and to what degree they're vaccinated as well. So that's another variable to look at. You know, test positivity needs to come down. And we still, like, we can't be in a position where we're still moving people out of province from an ICU perspective. So there's still some variables there that, you know, we have to look at. And we think those numbers are going to come down. Obviously, we think there's a bit of a plateau. Hopefully they're coming down, but we could see some more hospitalizations and ICU usage over the next week for sure. So there isn't a set number for each one of those variables that you describe. You know, we're going to take a look at all those variables, and we're going to look at some other variables like I described as well. And we're going to take a look at what the risk is and what we're able to do and what's going to be a priority for Manitobans as well when we look at restrictions and orders going forward. So again, more information on that will be out next week.
Because we're sitting at total ICU burden of more than 160 patients, given the numbers in Ontario and Saskatchewan. Yesterday was actually 166. So that those 40 patients aren't going to disappear by the end of next week. It's pretty obvious you're not going to be able to relax restrictions next week. Are you just prepared to give Manitobans that warning right now? Because ICUs are not out of the woods for weeks and weeks, it looks like.
Yeah, so the numbers I have, there's a 65 in Manitoba ICU related to COVID. In Manitoba, there's 125 ICU beds utilized, not just for COVID, for other purposes. Plus, there's another 41 out of province in ICU as well. Those that are in ICU out of province, even if beds were available here in the ICU, I think we'd wait until their ICU stay is they're at a discharge point before we repatriate people back. And so that's going to take some time. You're right. You know, when you look at ICU numbers declining over time, you could look at maybe a 10% per week or 5 to 10% per week on average, depending on the population that's in the ICU. So it's going to take some time for that. Where are we going to be at in with the next set of orders? I think you're right. I think we're in a tough spot here still. We have our case numbers still need to come down. Our acute care system is busy. We're going to see what we can do and look at a risk perspective there to see what we can do with the orders. But obviously, there'll still be restrictions in place. That's not going to change. The question is to the degree. And if we do loosen something, I don't expect it would be major changes to the orders, to be quite frank. It'll be subtle changes because that date's coming up. And again, it still is about 10 days out. So we'll have to see what those numbers look like.
From the Canadian Press, Steve.
Hi, Dr. Atwal. As we see more people age 12 and up getting vaccinated, does the vaccination rate also play into the formulation of public health orders? I mean, obviously, the healthcare system and the burden on it, the overburden, is the biggest factor. But does the increasing number of vaccinations play into that as well?
Yeah, for sure it does. The greater number of people that are vaccinated, that means there's some immunity out there that reduces, even if someone is exposed, transmission chains, the risk of developing a transmission chain. It reduces the risk of generating cases, which in turn has a reduction in the risk of developing hospitalizations and ICU stays. But even with 12-year-olds getting access to vaccine, remember when you get that shot, it still takes a couple weeks to develop that immunity with the first shot and the second shot thereafterwards, another 2 weeks thereafterwards. So even when those individuals are able to access vaccine or get the vaccine right now, we're not going to see the merits of that for a couple weeks down the road. We still have a lot of people in Manitoba who need their first dose. And obviously, there's a lot more people who need their second dose as well. So that does play a role in our risk assessment in relation to, case generation and the risk to the acute care capacity. So we will be looking at those numbers and we'll be looking at those specific age cohorts as well.
And we're seeing more studies come out all the time in terms of the various variants of concern, the Delta variant. There was one study, a relatively small study group that came out today that said perhaps the Pfizer might have more limited than expected efficacy against the Delta variant. Are we tracking the variants thoroughly? How thoroughly are we screening every sample in the province?
So we have a screening process to look for variants of concern that we're able to. Obviously, there's some variants where a screen isn't viable, that we just haven't been able to develop a screen for it. Whenever there's an infection or a reinfection, wherever there's an infection in a high-risk situation or a outbreak scenario, we do automatically send those samples for sequencing to make sure we know the genetic makeup of the virus at that point. We have to be cautious when we look at studies. You want to make sure we don't base decisions typically off of one study, a small study. We want to look at a number of different studies. There's different types of studies out there, which mean, different things when you're interpreting the data. So we're continuing to look at that information. We just don't do it locally. We have a national task force that we loop in with on a regular basis. We have meetings regularly throughout the week discussing these matters. discussing matters of vaccine effectiveness relating to, you know, new variants, new studies that come out. And we share that information internationally as well, because every jurisdiction has a native or a wild strain of COVID compared to us. So we learn off each other as well. So it is early to look at how effective a vaccine is to some of these newer variants of concern. As the Delta variant, as we get more and more information, we'll be able to provide some better numbers and provide some better evidence on true vaccine effectiveness related to those variants as well. And in the world of vaccines and vaccine development, there's ongoing vaccines being developed, and some of them are specific, you know, to some of these newer variants as well. And again, it takes months to get that information to run those studies. And from a public health perspective, again, both, you know, not only locally, you know, provincially, but nationally and internationally, all that information is reviewed to provide Manitobans with the best information that we're able to provide Manitobans.
Our final reporter this afternoon, Doctor, from CTV Winnipeg, Michelle.
Hi, Dr. Atwal. I wanted to ask for an update on the military personnel that are here, where they're working and what they're doing. And if needed, could they play a role in setting up like a field hospital? Is that still on the table? And is that something the military could help with if we do need it, since we haven't reached that third wave peak yet?
In relation to exactly what the armed forces are doing, again, I have a little bit of information. My job isn't intertwined with what the CAF does. That question is best posed to Shared Health. They'll have the exact details of what the CAF does. In relation to risk to the acute care system, we're busy. We're sending people to other provinces. Our neighboring provinces have helped out. I don't think and I don't feel we're going to require a field hospital, to be quite frank. I think our numbers, on our case numbers, obviously have peaked. They're coming down. I think our ICU and hospitalization numbers, I'm hoping they're plateauing right now. Perhaps not. Perhaps they're up about 10% over the next week. But even in that situation, I don't anticipate us requiring extra assistance than what we already have, and that's a guess, but we do have that assistance available to us from, you know, Alberta, Saskatchewan, and Ontario right now.
Thank you. We had a lot of talk today about the Delta variant. Maybe can you just give us a little bit information on what this variant is? Where did it come from, and why is it a variant of concern?
So it's a variant of concern. It's a variation of the COVID virus, so COVID-19. So just like, you know, a previous variant, like the Alpha variant or the UK variant or the B117 variant, this is the B16172 variant, which is called the Delta variant, which was also called the Indian variant as well. It first originated in India. The early evidence, it is more communicable. There are some thoughts that it might be more aggressive in relation to causing hospitalizations. And again, the literature is very early on that. So a variant, there's hundreds of variants out there. A variant of concern, it would be more in keeping with something that might have a greater impact in relation to the virus. Causing more infections per case is one of those. Causing more hospitalizations, causing more ICU stays, or causing more deaths would make it a variant of concern. So, you know, we're going to continue to see other variants. I mentioned that earlier. And that's the nature of COVID. That's the nature of viruses. They evolve. You know, they evolve rather quickly. The greater amount of virus there is out there, the greater the number of variants that are going to get generated. In a global setting, there's probably hundreds and if not thousands of variants out there. And, you know, we're still learning about a lot of the variants. So, you know, we know of a few of them. We know obviously some are more communicable and some are more aggressive. We're sure of that now. Let's say the UK variant. Others we're still learning. And with the Delta variant or the Indian variant, the early literature does support that it is perhaps more communicable. And we're still learning about its impact on morbidity and mortality as well.
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you, everyone. This concludes our media briefing.